on now? Hello, hello.
Yes.
Oh yeah, Trevor just Michael? Will not.
Michael has the same problem. I checked the tank.
I was telling you about the
Unibig
tank. Too late, now you're not going to find out.
Oh! Wow.
And this, but if I can get that audio driver, Steve, that would really make all the difference.
I'm just.
I need
Touche.
Touche. So tell us about the audio driver.
Never duel with the master.
So what's with the audio driver?
I don't know what you're referring to.
Is it going to be the Vermigo OS or Maddie OS?
Oh, shit. These guys, oh my goodness.
See, I know.
The problem is they're too smart. You can't pull stuff. So we're going to get going here. Mark is going to present something interesting about new gadgets that he's been working on. And then... then we'll see how time works, and we'll do Daniel in the afternoon. He's got some really cool stuff about skateboard acceleration and all sorts of interesting topics. So I'll give it over to Mark. Thank you, Mark.
I joined a month ago. My first project was a UGAD class called Info Data Gadget class. It's very similar to our label class, which is presenting data that can be changed on the fly, not static. Got stuck. I was using button gadgets and bored of this. Just change a test of that. If you do one at a time, individually. This can be done all in one swoop, or line by line. I've always wanted it for Workbench Explorer. I use three down here, 1, 2, 3, just to show your data there. So I'm using button classes and just change the text. I can do it line by line.
That's better.
So it's just a simple. Road, the height is static, the width can change. You only have X amount of lines. Just a simple way to change your data. That's something new.
That's right. Can you disable the resize gadget when you instantiate it?
Left the window, so. Width like it is there. You say, I want to go this big. You say, give it a minimum height. I'll show you the width. I'll show you that in the next one.
Could you just put it inside of a window without a border? Whatever you wanted to do. I mean, your class is really what's inside that window border.
It's just
so it doesn't have to be in a resizable window.
Is it right here? Right?
Yeah.
So it's just. This is the box.
Yeah.
Right. Static size. Or background color, which you're used to. This is the transparent color, so you can see here. So like here, you have the ellipses.
Yeah, the new sex. Yeah.
Whoa, look at that.
Whoa.
New sex.
Dude, he's even got different justify options.
Yeah, so
come on.
Right line, left and left center. Background colors, label colors, text colors.
This is like movie.
We girl.
Don't say that word.
We're going to hide this text, so it's how many lines you have. So.
which is much easier than List Browser gadget before to do that kind of trick.
So little images in there, separate bars.
A lot of stuff. A lot of stuff.
The center, there's a pod. Alt. Cut off the glimpses, so there's more.
Oh, you have little glimpses on either side, too.
First of all, the center, right?
Oh, yeah. About time.
Yeah.
Can you designate that with the ellipses?
Like, put center on or off, so like center one collapses in the middle.
You can say sure or not.
So
This is somehow, this is the minimum size, one character. You shrunk down to whatever. All your cool font. Styles, bold, italic, colors. Down here, I'm using three down here. Here, you put an image in there, it's a little progress bar. It's an image, not the true project bar class. Or progress bar. I think you have a long name. Where's your downloads folder sheet?
Data? So it's an assign. It's called downloads. You know, it's kind of weird. There you go. Might be big. I like the type. There you go.
You guys have a long name down here.
Ooh, a little chunky on my little machine.
It'll start putting ellipses in there, so you can cut it off. Before the button class, you couldn't, it wouldn't do that. Button class didn't support it.
Sometimes it's exported and rendered right off.
Well, it's also called button class.
That's all we have.
You know,
it's a flexible little button.
Not quite.
Yeah, I always wondered why we had button class to show read-only text.
We had it
only
doing it.
We did. If you encapsulate another class inside the button class, then it would work.
And
it's a
clickable.
I know, it's so
but
silly.
We didn't have it. That's pretty straightforward.
Can you, you have some examples of the code for a structure? Like, what are any of your examples?
Yeah, all six demos have the code in there.
So, I had a question. Of course, somebody's going to say, can I click on a URL?
Yes.
I think you were talking about that.
That's my next one.
So that's another class.
Yep.
Nice. And then it would go through the URL prefs or something or other?
Nope.
No?
We do that next time. Minimize to a row to, you can cut it off. And the number of rows is number of labels. So if you want five rows, you just say I have five rows and then go to the index, zero. That's your first line. Give it the color text, font, whatever, style. Go to index one, be a different style, different color. Index two, give the text, different style, different color. It's kind of like you're making a list browser of nodes. You have to make the node, go to that one node, say node one, is this text, this image, whatever. Same concept, but you do it all at once.
And
change it. Still set gun, set gadget, attributes, go to index, give a new text.
Oh, nice.
Real simple.
Yeah.
It's not static. You can do one line at a time, you can do six lines at a time. You can
do like animations and things too, right?
Do what?
Animations and that kind of craziness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good, I guess, we're just changing the image real fast.
Yeah, I suppose. No. He hasn't asked for that yet. It's next week.
Very simple, yeah.
Just for displaying info.
Right. Information, data. Label class, static.
Well, yeah, that's because it's a label image.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I might not.
You don't have the internet yet, either. Let's do this. These are here.
Ah.
This is the data here, here, here. This is still a label class because mine is an offer word graph on the long text. Do ellipses. That's we'll cut off the text. So we'll just make a window wide so you can read it sometimes. I had to do a trade-off.
Yep.
This will show ellipses here for long names, but up here a word graph with label class.
Right.
This is important. That's going to be changing, not this. So. Can't show you here. That's where you can also right now come down through and change the majority of it. It's very straightforward, very simple. After the class, not finished yet. Hang on, if this is something to do in your about window, what's not working yet is the hover. It should hover and change the highlight I'm over it. It's going to be the same concept. Click that, get off it. Now it's a visited color. You go on the page, just say it. All you get is a gadget up signal. The programmer then to decide what to do with it. My web page link, my email link. Just like a media guide link to the next page, change tabs,
whatever
you want with it. It's just a simple presentation. Here's your text. What's it going to look like eventually? The idea is this. When you go over it, the mouse is going to change. Your typical web link. Underline it, change color, change image, whatever you want to do. You click on it, it goes where you want.
Up
to the corner.
It's not hooked up to the internet,
correct?
So
that's something more simple too. Something to throw in your about window, give you a link, and then try and get it to go inside Google Data Class. But that's down the road. You can't put a gadget in a gadget. Only an image in a gadget. So that's probably 85% done. So that'll be out soon. The plan is to get it on Answer Pack 1.5 for Christmas. So, be out here soon.
So, Mark, how is this going to get distributed? Let's say I wanted to use your info data class, for example, and I wanted to distribute it. So, how does that work?
Matthew has an answer for that. The plan is to release it on 1.5 for Christmas.
Right.
And this plan is to make an answer pack of just gadget classes.
It's going to be a free and also it's going to be called Enhancer Essentials or some sort of name like that. And that will be for all developers, be an SDK to download with the gadgets. So you can develop with the Enhancer gadgets. And it's going to be a bit like UE.
Well, right, but as a developer, let's say I wanted to write a program. It's really distributable.
Yep.
I assume there's no charge for the use of the gadgets.
Well, you just have the gadget will be downloaded, the gadget set will be downloadable. So if you want to write for those gadgets, one of the precursors for running a program with those gadgets is the user download.
No, I understand that. What I mean is, so for example, with some MUI gadgets in the past, it was free to use as an end user. But if you were a commercial developer, sometimes you had to pay a license fee or something for that purpose. Are you all planning on doing anything like that?
No.
Because it's freely distributable to all.
We haven't got any plans to do that.
Oh.
I don't see the sense of doing
that. Right, and if you want people to use the gadgets.
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. I'm looking forward to it.
It's pretty straightforward.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to going to the Autodocs.
Yeah. Those demos are in the package and the full Autodocs.
I would like to congratulate you. That is the that is the first reaction gadget that's part of the enhancer that I've looked at, where I thought, wow, that's significant value over what's included with the operating system.
What about Intel Windows?
I've seen that, but it's nice.
An advertisement.
It's not an advertisement.
Yes.
It is nice, and it's very easy to use if I wanted sort of a tab about window. But I can't see it being used for any other purpose.
And in gadget?
I haven't tried that yet. So maybe some evangelism here is needed. So I've installed all the stuff from the enhancer tags, but that's terrific. Like I can actually see myself using that for a whole bunch of different tasks.
Yeah.
Well, that's
all the exposure.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Simple, straightforward. That's cool.
No trick to it.
List programming. Have you list browsing for everything anymore? Or,
yeah. And it's a
15 million button gadgets hidden with no border.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Did you put it in your version of Explorer already, or not yet?
It's built into it. It's not standalone, so that's where I developed it. Inside Explorer, all the tools are there. It's faster. It's easier. It's quicker. It doesn't crash. It doesn't flush the gadget out and re-load the new one. So.
Very nice.
Very nice. Debug session of my DSI problem?
No.
Was that medical?
No. That's a different issue. Right? And that rash has gone away. It's fine.
Show us how you fix bugs in the OS.
Yeah.
How give us a demonstration of fixing bugs in the OS. How many can you fix in an hour?
Is this a challenge?
Yes.
In
fact, we can give you a list.
Well, I do have some more. I could show some more SATA drives.
Yes, please.
I don't know if.
Yes.
There's
yes.
One person interested.
Yes.
Is it finished?
The number two
is it finished? Yeah. Software's never finished.
It's
We're like artists. We need time.
Was that? Are you feeling the pain?
I'm interested, for example, on things like buffering setups, how you're forming commands, what fields you have to supply, which ones you don't.
Really?
Yes. Huh. I want to bang on hardware.
Well,
aren't
you the curious monkey?
Yes.
It's all just smoke and mirrors. It never really worked. But don't tell anybody. Oh, mercy. Well, I don't use GUIs, so shell. Oy, Munga, what was I doing? Okay.
I mean, if you want to, I didn't mean to push, but I am interested in that topic.
You can later. This is just
junk source. I don't think you want to see the junk.
No, I don't need to see your junk. Oh, Visata. Now we're talking.
Where is the monastery? It's kind of hard to do without a monastery. How do you make the font if you're doing something?
Last year.
Global? Oh, yeah, it's Aeon Technologies' fault, too.
Whoa!
In case you're curious.
Matthew strikes again.
They're looking at the copyright banner. Evil is at work. So, like I was talking about yesterday, I have this virtual SATA device, right? Well, the virtual SATA device is just like every other device, and you have to have a device-like interface. So like Jamie was showing, you get these little bits of tags everywhere, all linked together to make your device. You got the manager, the other thing is you start the manager
layer down to your device structure.
Device structure is next.
And then down to your unit structure.
Down to your command structure. So the vSATA device is the same thing. What happens is it here's my white board. Maybe we need some more light now. Yes, thank you. That's talking about.
Are you getting a presentation?
Maybe in trouble. Yeah.
Is that something
vSATA device is actually talking to Mounter Task. So Mounter Task is the guy who's scanning your media.
Right.
So he's saying, okay, what's on there? I want to read block 0, block 1, block 2, right? That's what he's doing.
How does he get instantiated in the first place? See, I assume that's the task that's spawned by Monitor Library. So
yes.
Who initially opens the...
That's great.
Oh, that's the actual driver itself.
The driver itself.
The P1022 SATA device.
Okay.
That guy, he talks to an API, an announcement API. He calls this function called announce device or something. Announce, and he says, there's something that on my port, you see, right? So you plug something into the SATA little interrupt happens. It goes zing, zing, zing through the driver, and then bing, I'm alive. Oh, announced to mounter library. So okay. It goes to mounter library. Mounter library goes, oh, you announced something. Talks to this guy, says, okay, you go scan it. Here's the address, the name, and the port number. You go find out what's on there.
Right.
And he goes in there and he talks to the SATA, B SATA, and he's scanning now, right? He's reading data. He would look at your, it'd be kind of like Brill, he'd be scanning the lowest level, right? What's on there? What kind of file systems are on there? And then when he finds a file system, he'll actually launch the file system and say, okay, use this device as this port number. Go yak away. Right? And that's what happens. Right? But when the file system's talking to it,
it's a little...
That's where I have to figure out which unit are you talking to.
The B SATA, or are you talking to the driver?
I'm still working. I think it's talking to B SATA.
I would think so. Otherwise, would you have the old
one? Yes. And then the B SATA does the port mapping to the actual physical port.
Right.
And then back.
Is the purpose of B SATA primarily because we just run out of unit IDs over time if we're doing a lot of hop plugin?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's a fixed limit of the amount of units that you can map to.
Oh,
because they map to physical. They don't necessarily map to physical ports.
No, there's 64,000 unit numbers. So you're not going to run out anytime soon.
So in theory, here's my question. Other than making it easier for future driver developers to support things like hot plugins, why would you use vSATA instead of handling it directly in the device driver?
Well, if you handle it directly, it turned out to be just a bear, a mess, because you're mixing two concepts together, and the code became unmaintainable.
Okay.
That's what happened. Try it. The obvious way first is just let the driver do it, right? And well, that's why you can't pop a DVD out, pop a new CD, and it just works, because it's got, you're switching unit numbers. You can't do that. Unit numbers are fixed. But yet they're not fixed.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Right?
Yeah, I gotcha.
They're fixed, but they're not fixed. How can it be two things at once?
Right.
And that's what all the other drivers get wrong. So it doesn't work.
If you take out a CD and put in CD2, pull that one out, put CD1 back in.
Yeah,
this one. Are the various components intelligent enough to know that CD1 was the prior CEO.
Yes, yes. See, that was part of the problem.
With the floppy disk and the timestamp
and
all that.
And in the current driver, if you pop a CD in, take it out, put it in again, it has a different number.
It does now.
Like
you have to. How are you going to?
Different device number. Well, you don't need to do it. You didn't have to close the device designation.
Well, how are you going to know the first CD is back in again in the future?
Well, that's bumper library's problem.
How is it going to know?
Linux is it's using TRIPS. It tries to serialize it somehow. Like, figure out how do I know it's really unique.
Right. Now, mounter library right now just understands RDB and what other drive formatting profile formats does it support? What other drive format protocols does mounter library support besides RDB?
Oh, a whole host of them. But the real problem. Yeah.
So will that be expanded in the future to support all of the devices?
All the file systems?
And all the drivers. I mean, right now it only supports USB, right? You hook up a PC hard drive to your SATA port, and will mounter library come in and go, look, it's a PC formatted hard drive. It's got this.
On USB, it already does.
On USB, right.
Yeah.
But what about on SATA?
Yeah, it'll do the same thing.
Or whatever.
Yeah,
it
will. Yeah, it's automatic. So you just get all of your library services. So it would actually show up in that little GUI.
Now, but that GUI is only theoretically for Mac storage.
Well, not anymore.
Now, so what happens?
I haven't changed the title yet.
Okay. What happens when you have, as it stands right now, the current beta OS, if you
insert a drive, and let's say it's running EXT file system. My understanding is the only way to mount that file system currently is you have to somehow find out what the geometry of that is, and build a mount list, and then mount that mount list to get that partition to show up.
Well, that's what modern library says.
Well, it doesn't now, but yeah, you're saying it will.
It does.
It should.
It does. Yeah, I know it does.
I've used that. It doesn't work. We talked about it. It was like the only way anybody could tell me to do it was you have to build a mount list and mount that.
Wait, are you doing the mounter tool or the mounter library?
Mount command. You have to build a mount list with the geometry of that drawing because it's not a.
Mount command is not a tool.
Shouldn't be, it sounds like, but it is now.
Not by me, I never used it. I don't know why, who's telling you to use it, but.
Because it's not mounting the drive on it.
What did it?
The operating system is not mounting a drive, but it doesn't recognize the
box. What'd you plug the drive into?
USB in one case, and I think we tried it all with sales.
Well, there's a bug, it's just first entry.
Because we are back to the word show, that's where
yeah.
we...
Oh, absolutely, it's just right.
It does, and it's not
operating. I don't know, that's a bug. So. Okay. No, it does do everything I need it to right now. You have a device that does work, as usual.
So we're back to show.
As usual, the USB standard is...
Well, that's the thing, USB, you can see the drive was connected.
Well, that's just that's mounter library not doing its work.
So, in theory, what we have on our hands should be doing that. But it's not
absolutely.
It's updated.
So that's the whole purpose. Otherwise, why have it?
Why? I figured it was incomplete. It was just not done yet.
It's not incomplete. We just don't know what you're talking about. Is there a bug report?
Well, no, because I didn't know it was a bug. And it's like if I thought it should have worked, then it would be a possible bug.
Oh, no,
now all we need to do is get definition work on it.
Yes.
So you wondered on them on their mind there from touch.
That's shocking.
Yeah, I
know. I don't know.
No, it's not shocking.
No, it's shocking. Why would we just ignore you?
They're all ignored. I know.
No. It's just you. Okay. Sorry, if I remember where that penalty had a question on that one. Oh, why did I close the blue chat? Whoops. So you're asking like where the driver mumbo jumbo was, right? Yeah. Well, here's some of it. Liberty T core, it's called.
Right.
By some guy. And so Red Hat and Jeff was Carson.
Well, Jeff was the guy who started.
Yeah. So this code is the same as the Linux code that I've been working with. It is the Linux code.
All right.
There you go.
All right. So you're doing the normal thing where you're effectively what you're doing is you're taking the Tractix device commands and you're mapping it to libada calls, and you've got to do a whole bunch of this stuff as well in the beginning. But otherwise, that's basically you're basically mapping to this guy,
yep.
And then passing things such from the the I.O. messages, to the Amigo as I.O. message format, over to the calls to this library, and back to panel.
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Okay.
Can't hear LD.
Really? What is the on the init side of the device?
Yeah.
So AmigaOS doesn't have like a concept like control blocks. So how do you? What structure? What is the struct that you're using to keep all of the device information, like geometry, addressing, all that fun stuff? What does that look like?
Well, that's a big complex mess.
Okay.
Of structures, it's a big mess of structures. I could make a bit, little demo of some of it. I can click buttons. It's probably over here. Put it in there. Every feature on the planet.
Right.
So there's a little small taste of some of the enums.
Right.
Some macro stories.
How much of this stuff do you actually have to specify when you do the device initialization on the Amigo OS side? So when you actually do the initial device init in libATA in the object that you instance.
Yeah.
How much do you actually have to specify?
Well, the API is pretty thin.
Okay.
There's not that many functions.
Okay.
Call into the API. Yeah. So it's pretty thin. There's a few functions, but it's not the end of the world. Remember where it is? Nope. LibATA in general is designed so that you can plug in any SATA device.
Right.
Any, it could be PCI one or whatever, right? PCI Express. So what they did was they consolidated all of the API into one file that you needed to customize. And this one's for Freescale, FSL.
Okay.
That's short for Freescale. And
Yeah, Freescale Linux, right.
And this is the 3 gigabit per second SATA driver, right? And you can see on the right side, it's fairly sizable, but containable, see?
Mm-hmm.
Like I had to specify all of that stuff, and then the rest of the framework just took care of everything else for me, right?
Very nice.
Yeah. Stuff again, Jerry. So what happens is on the Amiga side, you call these kind of things to get the whole thing initiated, and there's one function called say scan port scan or something.
Port scan sounds right.
Yeah, port scan. That's the function you call, and then the framework's kicked into motion.
Cool.
Right. It just goes. And you're like, well, where's the data go? Well, it has callbacks and all sorts of things to let you talk to. Here's some of the structures. What's this IRQ coalescent? So this is a little feature to get rid of IRQs because there's too many otherwise. But it's the particular function for this particular chip. Because this chip supports coalescent IRQs. Some chips might not. It's got some little blurbs in here that actually do it. See, these are all Linux functions.
Spin lock.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I wrote my own spin lock. So I got my own write 32. Like these functions don't exist in Amiga, so
right.
I made equivalents. Well, I know both frameworks. So and a Linux driver framework and Amiga OS framework. So once you know those two, it's pretty easy to jump back and forth. But if you don't, you're not going to have fun. Right, Katie?
Yeah.
What's this one? That gets a tag. So, yeah, that uses a concept of a tag for native command queuing.
Okay.
It's called a tag. That's how you get your data back. Not really that. Set up entry, HGR entry. That's plus HGR set. This is for command queuing.
Oh, maybe header.
Header. That's what it is.
Header.
Yep. Fill SG, that's fill scatter gather, that's for DMA. So you prepare your DMA transactions. All that wonderful code. But this is specific for this chip again, right? This is for our P1022 chip. Now if you had PCI Express with whatever chip on it, you'd have to rewrite this function. Or replace, maybe it doesn't have scatter gather that chip, which would be highly unusual, but whatever.
But presumably,
yeah.
The IC manufacturer, the controller manufacturer, is going to have some sample driver code somewhere that you can use for this. Hopefully.
Well, that's the best part. Because
libATA is used every
99.9% of the time they give you a Linux driver.
Yeah.
They give you this file. Because it's GPL. You're already that close to finishing, right? That's the beautiful thing. So as long as they didn't do some weird Linux feature that they're using,
right,
something odd, that you have to replace in Amiga OS, you're okay. There's QC prep, that's command Q. QC is the Q command. So that's preparing for it. There was another function. Oh, look, there's some debug in there. That's a problem. Issue a command. There's a little command, a function to do an issue. Oh, yeah, see, I think what I was doing is I was having trouble on port 1 for some reason. So I put that on B. It's debugging something. I got to remember what I was doing.
At some point, are you going to type up some write-up on how you navigated doing this? Because it occurs to me that between Jamie's generic template for setting up a driver and the example that you've got here, and the fact that we've got an example in this on how to use libATA, there's no reason that it really opens things up to people to write new drivers for new controllers, PCIe-based controllers.
Yeah.
But people are probably going to want to know exactly what they've got to do to fill in. They're getting sort of a guide to libATA.
That could be nice.
That would be really great. Something.
I don't know.
It's boring because it's
not really nice, but
well,
and you've got all that spare time.
But between those two pieces, right?
It's this file, SATA FSL. There'll be one called SATA
whatever
chip manufacturing, right? You already have that. What you need is, how do I glue that to that, right?
Right.
That's the Wikipedia article I'm writing for you.
Exactly.
Yes. Yes. How do I glue that?
Right.
Yeah, so I was going to do a step-by-step, because it's not that bad.
Because
as long as you stick with libATA, it's not that bad. If you make your own stack to
ATA
device,
no.
Good luck to you.
No, my point is that looking back through all the documentation that we've had, we've never really had the pieces to do all this before without having to do all sorts of discovery.
Yes.
And most of us aren't as brilliant as yourself and Mr. Kruger.
Oh, here we go with the buttering.
I've got a lot of bread needing buttering here. So. But the point is that we've never had this before. And this will really open things up in a way that I don't.
Well, that was always my plan. I'm just a year late. I've always meant to release this like at least a year ago, but real life, whatever.
Yeah. Okay. So, but there's a variant of this for tape work, presumably.
Yeah. Okay. Actually, it's an identical. symmetrical.
It's exactly the SATA controller block is licensed by Freescale. So basically, every Freescale chip, except with the exception of a couple of known bugs, every Freescale chip from this family has effectively the same SATA controller, except the very newest Freescale stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. There's a header file that says how many ports. That's what you change.
Okay.
Oh, and it has 3 ports or 4 ports or 2. That's and then the rest it just goes, because Freescale is like you say, just gives you all of their chips in one file.
Cool.
This file. That's it. You're
it's
done.
Nice.
Right?
It's nice having common peripherals like this on a whole family of SoCs. You will need to do this once.
Yeah. Yeah. That was nice of Freescale.
Yeah,
I don't know how other manufacturers work. Maybe they have one per chip line or peripheral variant or whatever. They do whatever they want to do, right? And what I do is I go into the Linux source tree and I just figure it out. start prepping, right? Look here, look there. Oh, there's a link. There's another link. And kind of pull it out. I just pulled that out with a web browser, just perusing the kernel. I didn't even use any tools. Click. You know, yeah. So that's the nice thing. So whatever, as long as it has a Freescale chip, this will work. But I'm sure you're going to have some other manufacturer's chip.
Marvel or somebody.
Now there, once in a while you'll see an IFDEF in here. There's one, P5020 driver, see?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, what's that? Fix me, S power. The X5000 doesn't seem to like you. Blah, 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 blah. Right? So there's some problem that he thought he found that I don't agree with, but we're going back and forth on this. Because I went and said, all I need is this down here at the bottom. And he said, no, you need to do this. Once in a while you get a quirk. And where am I here? I'm in port start, right? What I didn't do yet, or I might never do, is replace their DMA API with the Amiga API. I don't know. It's another bunch of work I don't really want to do right now. Because in Linux they have DMA, Zetalog, Coherent. Right? This function?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, we don't have that in Amiga, so I replaced it with a LogMem tags. They're the same thing, but when, you know, I could just put a wrapper on this one myself. I just didn't bother yet because I'm lazy. I just use the LogMem tags. Right? I could go another step further and add another Linux emulation layer so that you, driver guy, don't have to worry about that, right? I'm kind of debating, yeah, it's more work, but it would make it easier for you, because now you don't have to change any code at all in the Linux driver, potentially, right? You still have to change the interrupt stuff.
Do you have a support.c somewhere that does all this remapping, fun stuff?
Yeah. I made
Linux
my
isms. I want to see your spin, I want to see your spin.
You want to see my spin lock?
Yeah.
Oh, no, that's secret. No, it's all cheap. Yeah.
Okay.
You kid. I don't remember which version it is. I've done like 3 versions of it. But I'm sure it's in C, because I don't like working in assembly. So I'm trying to be portable. I don't actually remember where I put it. See, there's some more Amiga-specific stuff. Cache clear E. What the hell is that? Stuff you don't have to do in the Linux side, but you have to do in the Amiga side.
Mm-hmm.
So you can imagine it was a lot of fun. You basically have these thousands of lines of code, and you go one by one, trying to figure out, do I have to substitute it for an Amiga function or not? Next Amiga, or not? Next. IOWrite32, I wrote another IOWrite32 for Amiga. like that over and over and over and over and over again. It's a standard Linux function, right? Or a Mac. Or B print K, right? There's no B print K anymore. So it would be an equivalent, just to avoid changing source code. There's DMA free coherent, right? Mm-hmm. So we don't have that function, but here's mine, free back. Parses. Looks a little nicer. No, there's dev classify. It's a device classify. What kind of device is plugged into the port? Hard reset. That's an interesting story. SATA has a very complex protocol when you reset the port, to reset the device that you have to follow. And there's all sorts of bugs in every device. And the libETI guys, they suffered through this for years, right?
Right.
Well, you get it for free. It's amazing.
Question?
Yes.
Is this published anywhere yet?
No.
So you're not GPL compliant?
No.
Do you want me to send you an official request to fix that?
Go ahead.
From a lawyer?
I don't care.
I'd be happy to do that. It's been years now.
2 years. Yeah. Yeah. No, it's not done yet. So once it works, I'm going to share it. But I don't want to share it until it works. I don't like sharing stuff that doesn't work that I wrote. So
what do you think are the incomplete portions?
The Amiga parts.
Can you be any more specific than that?
You weren't here yesterday, so you don't know. I spent most of the morning going through that.
Okay.
I don't want to do it again. They already know.
No, it's never.
They already know all that. We went through that with the device stuff. Like I said, if anybody wants a copy, well, I can send it to you printed out if you wish.
That was my suggestion.
We could do this. It would last another year back and forth. It will be compliant. Or just wait a little bit more.
It works.
Yeah. Well, Jamie has a copy because he wanted to do some stuff for your template, like
research.
It's not like you don't share with anybody. He just said, please don't send it out because it's not done. That darn Amiga glue has been such a bear.
Yeah.
Anyway, we are going to. There's the soft reset routine. Look, it actually, I don't have any if-defs in there. See, that's my goal, is to have no if-defs in any of the SATA FSL file. I'm trying to get to the point where there's not a single if-def Amiga in there.
Well, so far, the only thing that you've actually done that I can see is stuff around memory allocation and deallocation and your little spin lock.
That's what it's come down to, but it took me a long time to get down there. Before, there was ifdefs everywhere, right? This file was full of ifdefs. It took, I don't know, countless hours to get to this point. My goal is to make it easy for anybody else to port another one forever, right?
Right.
I don't ever want to come back to this. Ever. If there's a new board that comes out, it just works, right? That's what I'll I'm not that interested in SATA drivers anymore. So
yeah, I imagine you'd be pretty tired of it at this point.
Yeah. So the sooner the better. Well, but you see, once in a while there's a little thing for Steve in there or something, right? I was having trouble with Tabor. I found a bug in libETI.
No way!
Yes!
Impressive.
Yes.
Would I find you on the kernel mailing list?
I submitted a bug report.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. You know, I gave back to the baseline something.
Did they slap you down or did they collide?
Yeah. It's 99.9% take, but I gave one back. So they had a loop that was incorrect.
Ellie asked a really important question. Did they slap you down?
Of course, it's an obvious bug.
It hasn't been fixed upstream already?
No, Cool. It's been there for years.
That's impressive.
This bug's been there for years and years and years. And I said, oh my goodness, why did I have to find it? Because it wasted 3 months of my life. Because I remember we were trying to get Tabor going.
Right.
And I could not detect when a CD was put into the drive or injected or ejected.
Is that fixed now?
Yeah. It wasn't me. Like that, I thought it was me. I thought that they must have hit this. No, it wasn't.
Yeah,
it was the MAT was broken.
Yeah, you got to disconnect the CD.
Yeah, I bought four drives. I tried seven.
Right.
I thought, it's got to be me. It's got. I looked at the U-boot source code. I'm like, what the hell? It should work. Yeah, yeah. So once in a while, you run into something like that. It did take 3 months. Because I thought it was me, so I checked every corner of every piece of code. Now I suppose that's the good thing is I got a very thorough code review.
Right.
But man, yeah, you just waste your life sometimes these things. And all I wanted to do was detect when the CD was in there. It was flaky, like it would work sometimes.
What was the bug, out of curiosity?
There was a loop that was going too far. So it was looking into invalid memory.
Oh, okay.
But it was I/O space, so the current Linux kernel thought, oh, you must know what you're doing.
Yeah.
No? Okay. No? It was off by a few entries, not a lot, too. It's like an off by one error, but it was more than one. That was very frustrating. And it was in the native command queuing as well. So these native commands are asynchronous. So it's very well hidden. Very well hidden. And that was. Oh! I think that's it.
That's your workaround?
Yeah, isn't it? Where am I?
You're right past the bit where you were printing stuff out to see how to function.
Post-interrupt.
Yeah.
Post-interrupt routine. I think it was right here in the workaround for data lake mismatch errata. Yeah, this is the function. There you go. This number was wrong. Sata FSQ qdent. It was the wrong number. It was another number, which worked just as well, but it was too big. And I said, no, it's this one. Not the other one. I can't remember what the other one was. It was wrong. That's it. So it was a workaround for their own errata.
And they got it wrong.
Yeah.
That happens.
There for forever. It goes back 10 years.
Well,
so that's probably another reason why it was hidden.
Yeah, but how many people are using removable optical media with these controllers?
Us.
Yeah, exactly. So that's probably
that's why
the first to find it.
I think I begged Matthew at one point, can I just not support 8 Atapi, please? This is just draining my life.
Just tell him to hook up a USB drive.
Well, in the end, I did need the vSATA anyway to support eSATA. So if we just actually hard-coded it and say you have two ports, I could give you the driver now. Right? No problem, it works fine. If you have hard-coded ports and you never remove devices, it works fine. But want removable hard drives, they want removable media. Okay, I thought, well, that can't be that hard.
Famous last one.
A year later. So it's all this removable support that has caused all the delay. But yeah, the initial driver with the hard-coded ports, that was easy. It's working fine. Actually, yeah, if we wanted to do a PCI Express card with fixed ports, yeah, we could do that. It's not a problem. But then I discovered Mounter Library is a little bit bitchy, let's use the word.
Right.
And it's sort of acting funny if you don't do things a certain way. And then I found a bug in CD file system that slowed me down. And,
you said it doesn't work on any of the SIL controllers either that I discovered.
on the cell ones?
Yeah, I mean, with our drivers. I'm sure it works in PC. It doesn't work.
Yeah. Well, it barely works with our cell drivers, yeah. Because that framework, that's
pre-mounter library.
Yep, and it doesn't use mounter library.
Right.
It uses its own custom stuff. Yeah. That framework, I can't remember where we stole that from. BSD. I think it's for BSD.
Oh, that's not stealing.
I know,
perfectly happy for you to do that.
Technically, it's not stealing, but it's not shared. See, that's private source code. How are you supposed to write a driver for Amiga if we did it again, right? We take someone else's framework for ATA devices, we hide it,
right.
Put our Amiga wrap around it, and say, okay, you have a PCI Express card that you want to write a driver for? Good luck. You can't have any source code. WTF, right? So I went, I'm not doing that again. I'm going to do GPL this time. So everybody gets it. No more of this. Right? It's hidden in a repository deep within the Hyperion source code. No one can have it, right? Because it's top secret. I don't understand that. So. Because say Aaron comes along and we go on the lake, right? He wants to write a driver for a new PCI Express SATA card. He can't. He's gonna spend how much of Jamie's time? A year to write this all from scratch? Maybe 2 years if you had to write it from scratch.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't write this. To write that from scratch is ludicrous.
A lot of research before you even write the first plan.
Ludicrous. Yeah, it'd take a multi-year project just to get a disk drive.